The craft world of Biel-tan is infamous for its martial and aggressive nature. Unlike most craft worlds, who avoid unnecessary conflict, manipulating the lesser races of the galaxy to their own ends, Biel-tan has fully dedicated itself to the systematic eradication of every sentient life form in the galaxy. They wage an eternal crusade against those they deem to be usurpers of the old Eldar Empire. The Eldar of Biel-tan hold a special contempt for the orcs, for those brutish creatures prove exceptionally difficult to totally eradicate from a world. The world rune of Biel-tan symbolizes the rebirth of ancient days, a reference to the cycle of death and rebirth that existed prior to the fall, a reminder of the heights of the old Eldar Empire, and the state of being the Eldar of Biel-tan intend to return to. Biel-tan has more aspect warrior shrines than any other craft world, for unlike other craft worlds where Eldar are free to choose whichever path calls to them, Biel-tan mandates that every young Eldar must serve in an aspect shrine prior to their journey along the path. This creates a strong martial culture on the craft world, every Eldar abiding by a strict honor code. Biel-tan has a unique military structure among the craft worlds, the Bajakane, translating roughly to Swordwind. Unlike most other craft worlds that field their forces in small elite teams, engaging in guerrilla warfare and hit-and-run tactics, Biel-tan fields a main battle force, meeting their enemy on the field of battle and engaging their enemies head-to-head. The zealous expansionism of the Biel-tan was born in the dying light of the Eldar Empire. Biel-tan was one of the first craft worlds to leave the hedonistic lifestyles of the old Eldar behind, forging a new path for their people among the stars. Sometime later, with the birth of She Who Thirsts and the fall of the Eldar Empire, the Eldar of Biel-tan isolated themselves from the outside world, becoming incredibly rigid and militaristic, seeking to avoid the doom that had befallen their race through strict authoritarianism and martial order. With the revelation of the path brought by Asuman and the infinity circuits developed by Ianden, Biel-tan began to expand, seeking to reforge the old Eldar Empire in the new galaxy created in the wake of the fall. The first contact between the Eldar of Biel-tan and the Imperium of Man occurred during humanity's Great Crusade. An Adeptus Mechanicus Explorator fleet was attempting to settle the world of Gavris Minor when they suddenly came under attack. The Mechanicum had barely begun to unearth ancient Xeno's ruins before the Eldar of Biel-tan struck with inhuman ruthlessness. The Adepts sent a desperate plea for aid before all communication was lost. The Explorator teams immediately began to retreat as Eldar warriors hunted them down in carefully orchestrated attacks. The few that escaped the planet returned to find their entire fleet burning in orbit, abandoned to their fate in ships without warp capability, the Eldar leaving as swiftly as they had arrived. The only communication given by the Eldar throughout the incident was a broadcast delivered to the Explorator ground teams. The message stating, "The soil of this planet is not for your feet to tread. Only death awaits you here." In the 914th year of the 40th millennium, Warg Arbutz swept through the Xypher subsector, the location of several ancient Eldar Exodite worlds. These primitive Eldar exiles fought nobly atop their great beastly lizards, but the sheer scale of the orc invasion meant that the Exodites were too few in number to mount any meaningful resistance, and the WAG left once beautiful worlds desecrated in a matter of months. By the end of the fighting, the entire subsector lay in orc control. For almost 300 years this empire stood, till in the 204th year of Millennium 41, an Imperial Reclamation fleet was dispatched by the High Lords of Terra. Over 24 regiments of Imperial Guard were sent, including the 127th Death Corps of Krieg Regiment. A sizable Astartes complement was also dispatched to the system, including forces from the chapters of the Marauders, Eagle Warriors, Raven Guard, and Revilers. Over the next 20 years, the Imperium of Man engaged in a brutal campaign against the Orcs, till in the 224th year of Millennium 41, the entire subsector was cleared of the Orcish taint. As a reward for their bravery in the eradication campaign, the Death Corps 127th Regiment was given the world of Baran to settle. Small bands of feral orcs roamed the world, but they were quickly routed into the mountains. Unbeknownst to the human settlers, this world Baran was once the greatest of the Exodite worlds in this subsector, and was claimed by ancient pact by the craft world Biel-tan. In the relative peace of the next several generations, save the occasional attack from the feral mountain orcs, the world of Baran began to grow into a major imperial establishment. Soon enough, the world was capable of fielding its own regiments of imperial guard. These guardsmen would come to be known as the Baran Siege Masters. A small contingent of Raven Guard remained as well, establishing a fortress monastery and keeping constant vigil against any orc attempts to reclaim the subsector. This peace would not last, as the Craftworld of Biel-tan began to drift towards the Xypher subsector. These worlds lay within the kingdom of Biel-tan, at least in the eyes of the Eldar of that Craftworld. No world taken would go unclaimed, whether the perpetrators of this theft be human or orc. When these former Exodite worlds were first desecrated by the orcs, the last brave Eldar upon these worlds sealed their connections to the Webway, preventing the orc filth from spreading into that ancient realm the Eldar used to travel the stars, unimpeded by the machinations of lesser creatures. Yet one pathway remained, the path to the world of Baran. The gate was quite small, affording passage only to a single individual at a time. Not even the smallest of wraith constructs able to fit through the gap. Biel-tan sent scouting parties onto the world, but what the rangers found there disgusted them to their core. Hordes of wild orcs rampaged across the once beautiful landscapes. Rivers ran dirty, littered with all kinds of orcish detritus. Primitive war machines belched thick black smoke as they tore through the verdant grass, cleaving muddy scars onto the world itself. This desecration infuriated the Eldar of Biel-tan. Aspect warriors donned war masks. Ancient heroes were roused from their slumber. The court of the young king awakened the avatar of Kaela Mensha-Kane. The craft world itself thronged with the songs of vengeance. Biel-tan was going to war. The battle began as several dozen Aspect warriors emerged from the Webway gate, split into small teams led by Eldar seers. They made quick work of slaughtering the orcs present. Outnumbered almost 4-1, these Aspect warriors utilized their element of surprise, quickly making their way to the infinity circuit housing the souls of the Exodites that had lived on this world over 500 years ago. Spirit seers and bone singers worked in tandem, the bone singers forming wraithbone constructs while the spirit seers guided the souls of the departed Exodites into their new wraith construct bodies. With these reinforcements, Aspect warriors and wraith guard quickly routed the orcs. The first battle of the war for Baran was a decisive Elder victory. The Eldar of Biel-tan began a brutal campaign of vengeful slaughter, using the Webway network of the world to make quick and deadly strikes against orc encampments across the planet. Soon, the orcs began to flee, leaving their former encampments in the forests and mountains, choosing to attack the human settlements across the planets over the vengeful specters that appeared from the deepest parts of the forest. Several human cities were wiped out, and the guard regiments of the Baran Siege Masters could do little to slow the orc advance. The planetary governor sent an urgent request for aid to the fortress monastery of the Raven Guard, for the human settlers had almost no chance of survival without their aid. The Raven Guard did not heed their request, for they were few in number, and their efforts would be better focused elsewhere. Instead of aiding the settlers directly, the Raven Guard resolved to root out the source of the orcs' sudden aggression. It did not take them long to find out why the orcs were leaving the mountains and forests in groups larger than ever seen before. The orcs were not attacking. They were fleeing. Every orc encampment across the planet had been destroyed. Buildings lay in ruins, still smoking from the attacks. Orc corpses were strewn across the landscape, cut to ribbons by the lethal monomolecular shurikens of the Eldar. Biel-tan was intentionally routing the orcs towards the settlers, killing two birds with one stone, and massacring everything that had dared to invade their sacred ground. The Raven Guard scouting party located a group of orcs being massacred by the Eldar and quickly mobilized 6 Thunderhawks to hunt down these enigmatic foes. The Eldar immediately fled, but not so quickly as to lose their pursuers. The Thunderhawks opened fire and cut down several Aspect warriors, in spite of their attempts to evade them. The dwindling Eldar forces retreated to a clearing with a great ring of ancient monuments at its center. The Raven Guard disembarked from their transports, seeking to cut of the Eldar's escape and surround them. But as with so many things, it proved to be just as the Eldar intended. Wraith gates opened around the Raven Guard, as the entirety of Biel-tan's Swordwind emerged, surrounding the Space Marines. The Raven Guard stood their ground, but they only lasted a few scant hours. The Astartes' presence upon the world was completely eradicated. Meanwhile, the Orcs continued their flight, fighting not just the human settlers, but also warring among themselves. An ambitious Orc named Snagger from the Big Teeth tribe began attempting to take control of the Orc mobs, slaying the other war bosses that dared challenge him, and intimidating the others into falling in line. With the Orc tribes united, Snagger marched on the city of Endera, the oldest and largest city the human settlers had built. While the sheer scale of the Orc mob easily surrounded the city and began sieging it, any attempt to penetrate the defenses of the city were easily repelled by the Baran siege masters. Frustrated, Snagger withdrew to plot his next move. On the other side of the warfront, the Swordwind engaged Snagger's horde. Reinforced by the Craftworld, the Eldar slaughtered thousands of orcs. However, the immense size of the orc horde was too large, and the Eldar began to withdraw. As they fled, Snagger sat and gloated before setting his sights on Endera once again. As the Eldar retreated, several small groups of Eldar warriors were separated from their larger force. One such group was the striking scorpions of the Grieving Shrine. Something among the ruins called to the exarch of this shrine, and as the orcs pursued them, they found themselves in an ancient aspect shrine now hidden beneath dense vegetation. They quickly made their way through the ancient temple, seeking the Wraith Gate at its heart that would reunite them with the rest of their army. However, to their dismay, the gateway had been sealed, and no effort to open it yielded any results. As they prepared to make their last stand, their exarch noticed something glimmer in the darkness. The ancient relic armor of the Phoenix Lord Karandras, who had fallen in a last stand, buying time for the Exodites to escape, was half buried in the rubble. Donning the armor, the exarch was no more. Standing in his place was Karandras reborn. While the defeat had been a setback for Biel-tan, the war was far from over. With the arrival of a Phoenix Lord and the Space Marines out of the picture, they could redouble their efforts against the remaining orcs and human colonists. But without their super-heavy siege equipment, Biel-tan would be unable to take the cities. None of the gates the Eldar had opened so far were large enough for these weapons of war. Only one webway gate existed on the planet capable of bringing these ancient siege weapons to the fight, the Gate of Vol. The battle for the Gate of Vol would go down in history as one of Biel-tan's proudest moments. As the forces of Biel-tan drew near the gate, Eldar scouts reported that the entire Orc army had gathered there. The Orc line was immense, stretching out for miles. At the center of this formation was the concentrated mechanical might of the Orc army, including a pair of colossal gargants. The Eldar of Biel-tan knew they could not defeat the Orc army head to head. Their only chance at defeating them would be disabling the gargants, taking the Gate of Vol, and bringing in super-heavy reinforcements from the Craftworld. Swooping hawks and warp spiders formed a long, broken line of skirmish, baiting the Orc battle line towards them. The Orcs charged towards the Eldar battle line, but as they drew close, the Eldar withdrew, drawing the Orc infantry and light vehicles away from their heavy support. As the Aspect warriors withdrew, Eldar Phoenix bomber squadrons flew overhead, heading straight for the isolated heavy support weapons. Many Orcs turned around, racing back to defend their war machines. Their efforts would be in vain as the bombers dropped their payload on the undefended war machines. The bombing run was successful, crippling the Orc heavy weapons and even felling one of the gargants. With the Orc army in disarray, an elite Aspect warrior spearhead charged through the Orc lines, heading straight for the Gate of Vol. The fighting was brutal as the Eldar made their way towards the Webway Gate, cutting a bloody path through the Orc lines. As they reached the gate, seers began the rituals of awakening to activate the portal while their Aspect warrior escorts attempted to hold the line. The Eldar had reached their objective at heavy cost and were now surrounded by the hordes of brutish orcs. The surviving gargant wreaked havoc on the Eldar lines as the tides of battle shifted in favor of the orcs. The Eldar fought well. Every inch of ground gained by the orcs was paid in greenskin blood. But the Eldar were losing ground and lives, the gargant slaying dozens of Eldar with each swing of its enormous arms. Just as it seemed as if the Eldar would lose, the gate opened, and three Phantom-class Titans strode out, the concentrated firing of their main pulsar weaponry cutting down the Gargant with ease. The orcs routed and were mercilessly slaughtered by the Eldar of Biel-tan. The battle for the Gate of Vol was won. With that victory, the Eldar declared their claim on the planet. The human settlers either fled the world or were slaughtered by Biel-tan. Thus was the exodite world of Baran returned to its rightful claimants. On the twilight year of Millennium 41, the divinations of the Seer Council of Biel-tan, precipitated by the Mask of the Midnight Sorrow, led the forces of Biel-tan to the once beautiful world of Ursulia, an exodite maiden world ravaged by warp storms and transformed into a demon world. There, the demons of Slaanesh intended to breach an ancient webway portal called the Obsidian Gate that led to Biel-tan itself. A temporary alliance between the Mask of Slaanesh and Skarbrand saw the hosts of Slaanesh and Khorne fight the Swordwind of Biel-tan amongst a raging demonstorm. At the battle's height, the portal that led to Biel-tan was smashed open by Skarbrand's axe, allowing the Mask to pass through to reach the world ship beyond. From there, she polluted Biel-tan's infinity circuit with Slaaneshi demons in such number that the innate defenses of the Wraithbone megastructure was hard-pressed to cope. Slowly, the infinity circuit became corrupted as it was possessed by the very demonic forces it was devised to help the Eldar within it escape. Even as the Eldar of Biel-tan fought during what became known as the Battle of Biel-tan, with every ounce of their skill to quarantine and cleanse their home of the demonic infestation, the Inari, the newborn cult of the Eldar god of the dead Inead, passed through the webway to join forces with them. The Inari's high priestess and prophet Ivrain, under attack from a horde of demonettes, breathed out a cold grey mist that dissolved them amongst a horrible keening scream. The parley between Inari and the Biel-tani was strained, for there were those that wore the armour of the hated Drukhari amongst them. The presence of the Phoenix Lord Jainzar, who spoke out on Ivrain's behalf, bought enough time for the High Priestess of Inead to perform a ritual of her own. Ivrain plunged her hand into the psychoplastic wraithbone skeleton of the Biel-tan worldship, as if it offered no more resistance than water. When she drew it back out, she held high the second of the Kronzords that had been buried in the Craftworld spine for many Terran millennia. The infinity circuit, already racked with pain, began to shatter, and the backlash of deathly psychic energies formed a vortex of terrifying power. From that vortex emerged the Incarnate, Avatar of the Eldar god of the dead. Its coalescence had a terrible price, however. Though Biel-tan's infinity circuit was cleansed of demons by Inead's power, the craft world began to physically break apart. Worse still, roiling storms of psychic energy boiled through the void, joining with the empiric dissonance of several other cataclysmic events, such as the destruction of Cadia during the 13th Black Crusade, to form a large section of the Great Rift. Biel-tan was saved, though it would need solar decades to recover, but the galaxy itself had paid the price.